Good morning, everyone. I pray you had a great time with family and Christmas and all those wonderful things. Of course, sugar, ice cream, gingerbread, all that good stuff. Great verse up on the screen this morning. We have a God who cares for us. He's our great shepherd, and he watches over his flock. And this morning, we have so much to be thankful for. Let's stand and sing Count Your Blessings as we start off this morning.
When upon my pillows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and you will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, you are God.
Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a weary land.
Was it good? Happy birthday, Jesus. Yeah? Ready for the new year? Just a few days away. Can you believe it's the end of 2015 already? It just was here yesterday. Wow. Time flies. Let's stand and sing about all the kinds of reasons we have to bless the Lord. That video that we had up here was just a reminder of the shepherd who guards over us and watches over us. We have a lot to be thankful for, and we can bless God with it today.
Still my soul will sing your praise unending.
and will stand forever. Angels sing, glory, glory, hallelujah.
He already has. He's going to continue to reign. Let's sing this as we prepare for the message this morning.
Yes.
morning. We're thankful that you're always with us, but we just feel, I don't know, together as a body, just feel closer, and we're looking forward to you speaking to us today, teaching us things that maybe we haven't learned before, or just reevaluating some things, or enlightening us with some other things that are just going to cause us to worship you and recognize that rule and reign in our lives. I pray for Pastor Joe as he comes now to present it to us, that you would give him strength and speak to us, and your spirit would just come on us and let us feel his presence this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. What do you talk about in preparing people for a new year? I had a wonderful Christmas. I think you did too. I am limping a little bit this morning because my grandson has gotten heavier. But hey, it's a pain worth it when you got a little boy who wants his papa. And we just had a great time. Now, it was my little grandson, not my big grandson. That would be stupid, wouldn't it? I want to take you to the Word of God this morning, but in doing that, I want to remind you of what happened a few years ago. You probably remember it. It was on August the 5th, 2010, when all of those miners got stuck down in that mine in Chile, 2,000 feet below the earth, and for 69 days. As I recall, they had water, although it was not very good water, but enough to get them by. They had lots of cookies, 93 packages, little packages of cookies, one can of salmon, three cans of tuna, I believe it was, and that was supposed to last them all that time. But it was the fear of not knowing if you'd ever get out. That fear of barely being able to communicate with the folks out there. And then the joy of finally seeing that one metal cage come down and take them out one by one. Some of you have been through that. Not in a cave, not in a mine, not having to be in a little metal cage. But you've been through things like that in your life. Those times when you felt trapped. Times when you felt everything was closing in around you, felt that there was not enough to provide for you. Now, I say all of that this morning by telling you I'm not a prophet nor the son of a prophet. I remind you it is a nonprofit organization. But I can pretty much be assured that some of you will go through that this year. Some of our folks are going through it. Those times when it just seems God is not around, and your cries go out to heaven and they just seem to bounce off the ceiling. All of us have felt like that at times. And it may be that you'll feel like that this year. And I want to look into the lives of some people that will at least help us to understand what we ought to know and what we ought to do in times like that. I'm going to take you to John chapter 11 and the story of Mary and Martha and their brother Lazarus. You follow along as I read. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. You remember that was the two sisters who had a hard time getting along sometimes because one of them wanted to work and one of them wanted to play and worship the Lord and do all these things. They always had their problems, but they had a loving brother, and they loved him, and he was sick. Verse 2, it was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. So the sister sent word to Jesus, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. Now they made no request of him here, and I don't think they felt like they needed to. I think the very fact that they said, Lord, he said, he whom you love is sick, they thought surely Jesus would come. What word he sent back to them sounded pretty good. Notice the next verses here. Oh, I forgot. Yeah. Will you hold, please? Ever had that happen? See, they probably thought they were on hold, but they did get back a note from Jesus. It was like this, John 11:4. When Jesus heard this, he said, this sickness is not to end in death. That's all you need. Hey, the master says it's not to end in death. It's okay. It's all right. So the note comes. It's all right. Everything's okay now. The master said it will not end in death. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, so when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Something just doesn't seem right here. There's just not the feel that the story is going like you would like it to go. And so now the Lord tells his disciples. They don't know exactly what's going on, and so he said, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep. Now this is, as I understand, the first time in the New Testament that death is referred to as sleep. Now the apostles took up that theme and used it predominantly in the rest of the New Testament, because it really is a picture of what death is like for believers, like sleep. The body sleeps, but the spirit of the person goes on to be with the Lord. But he says, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep. But I go so that I may awaken him out of sleep. And you know, these disciples always say what they think is the right thing when they don't understand. Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover. Everybody knows sleep will do you good. That's why I love this service. This service does so many people such good. Because they, you know. You got to remember, though, I was a college professor, and I do have some rules for you. One of them is, if you feel sleepy, don't fight it. Don't fight it. It's a good place to sleep. Just kind of put your head back and think wonderful dreams. But if you do that, don't snore. And don't drool, please. Stella has a hard time getting that up. Now, Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought he was speaking of literal sleep. So Jesus then said to them plainly, as he had to on many times, Lazarus is dead. Let me tell you the plain truth. I'm not going to give it to you in metaphorical terms. Lazarus is dead. But they had heard him say, this sickness is not unto death. And then he goes on to say, and I'm glad for your sakes I was not there. That just doesn't seem to fit. It doesn't make you feel right about Jesus. He says, I'm glad I went there. I'm glad he died. You know? So that you may believe. But let us go to him. Again, they remembered passing on the note. They knew what Jesus had said, so something just isn't making sense here. This sickness is not unto death. He died. And there are times in life that are so like that for us. I mean, surely you've had times when you've seen God say something, or his word intimate something to you, or you feel like he's told you this is going to work out okay, but then it doesn't. This sickness is not unto death, but he died. Well, what do you do with times like that? You know, this happens a lot more in Scripture than you think. I mean, just a few examples will remind you of how often God does this. Something I've noticed throughout my years of ministry is that when God seems to directly contradict himself through what he has said or what you feel he has told you to do. It is often because he's ready to teach you a spiritual truth that you cannot learn in the normal activities of life. Some of us just do not learn with the normal stuff. And God has to do something really extraordinary that seems so contradictory in order to cause us to learn. I think of times like when Jesus or when God told Moses to tell the children this, go out of Egypt. I've got the promised land for you. It's a land of milk and honey. You're going to love it. Go out. You are free. And they go out. And what's the first thing they run into? The Red Sea. You know, they've got enemies to the north and south all around them. Pharaoh is behind them. What do you do? It was one of those times Jesus wanted to show them that he could open seas. He could part the waters. There's that old song I remember from a kid, when I think I'm going under, part the waters, Lord. Part the waters. And what amazes me is he not only parted the waters, but they went through on dry ground. And then I love the way Moses put it in his song. He said, God clapped his hands, and Pharaoh and his army all drowned. There are people who say the Red Sea was only about 3 feet deep, and so could have been much of a miracle. That's more of a miracle to me. You think about it. That whole army drowned in 3 feet of water? Whoa, that's a big time miracle to me. I think they got it wrong, but I think of times like we just studied recently in Hebrews chapter 11. Abraham told to offer Isaac as a sacrifice. That doesn't make sense. God had said in Genesis 9 that men were not to murder. He had said that the soul of a man is very important and murder was wrong. He had told him that Isaac and his descendants would be like the sands of the seashore. Isaac isn't even married. So if he kills him, how is God going to do all of these things? God seemingly contradicted himself in all of this. But it was a time that God used a ram to stand in substitution for Isaac. A big thing that seems so contradictory, and yet Abraham and the Jewish people have never forgotten that lesson. And then there are those times that just don't seem to make sense when you send out a kid to battle a giant. And yet, in spite of how contradictory it seemed, in spite of how ridiculous it seemed, God showed his people he could work through situations like that. Or even for a boy's lunch, you got some loaves and fishes, and Jesus is able to take that and feed 5,000 people on one occasion, 4,000 on another. That was pretty extraordinary. When I go back to it, God seems, when he seems to directly contradict himself, it is often because he's ready to teach you or teach me a lesson that we just don't learn in the ordinary day-to-day things of life. For Lazarus, for his sisters, Mary and Martha, this was one of those lessons. Let me show you how it turns out here. Notice the grave situation, and forgive the pun, but it really is a grave situation. So when Jesus came, he found that he'd already been in the tomb 4 days. I mean, he's waited. And when you think about him waiting, it also is true. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off. He could have come. He could have been there for 4 days. Now, that 4 days is a lot more significant than you may think. The Jews had a belief. I do not know where they got it. Haven't been able to find that in any studies. But they did have a belief that the body of or the spirit of a person hovered above the body for 3 days. And if possible, that the spirit could get back into the body within that 3 days, the person could revive. But 4 days? Not going to happen. 4 days and the body is beginning to rot. Now, they didn't have any reason for that belief. They didn't have any scientific studies, but that's what they believed. But 4 days, the is impossible. 4 days is ridiculous to even think about. And so Jesus has waited 4 days, and so now we have the response of Martha. You know the story. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." Now, I don't understand quite, Lord, why you weren't here. You're a busy man. You got people who want to be around you. And I know you love us, but you know, if you had been here, he wouldn't have died. But then she says, "Even now, I know whatever you ask of God, God will give it to you. Lord, I am a firm believer. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, even like Peter said. And I believe that if you ask God right now, he can raise you from the dead." Now, notice Jesus gives her a wonderful, biblical, as we know it, theological answer to the problem. Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha, don't you know your theology? He's going to rise again. You remember Daniel chapter 11, how my people will rise from the dust of the earth? Don't you know I'm going to rise, how in the end people are going to be resurrected? And I know that you've learned that in the Jewish synagogue, and surely you know that he's going to rise again. It's kind of like when you're suffering greatly and one of the brothers or sisters says, "Well, don't you know Romans 8:28? You want to take Romans 8:28 and shove it down their throat, don't you? It's like those times, I don't need the theology. I know it. I understand it. My brother's dead. Theology just doesn't change the way I feel right now." Martha said, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day, but that's the last day. This is this day." Mary had pretty much the same response. Therefore, when Mary came where Jesus was, she saw him and fell at his feet, saying to him, get out the tape recorder, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Same response. And it's the same way any of us would normally think. If God could work, God could have prevented this, God could have been powerful to keep him from dying. The one who is able to heal people could heal Lazarus. But he wasn't here. He didn't show up for it. He even sent back a note and said, "The sickness is not unto death." How do we deal with that? What I want you to see here, and we sometimes miss this in the passage, I want you to compare the responses. Because this is where we learn our lesson in this particular passage. The response of the two sisters, you saw it. They both said, "Lord, if you had been here, what? My brother would not have died. If. We love to use ifs. But here's what I want you to notice. We sometimes miss the response of Jesus. And Jesus said, "If you would believe, you would see the glory of God." You see, they both used their ifs in the situation. But his is the one that counts. If you would believe, you would see the glory of God. Are you the kind of person who ifs God all the time? I know I do. You know what happens when you if God? When you if him, you are saying God doesn't know what he's doing. But you do. Look, I've got it all worked out here, Father. If you do A, B will occur. No, look. Sir, I know what ought to be done. You missed it. If. Like we know what to do. But when you if God, you're saying that you don't like the way things have turned out, as though God has to answer to you. And he doesn't. When you and I, if God, we are questioning the omniscient, omnipotent, sovereign of the universe. What we need to understand is that it sets us up for his if back to us. If you would believe, you would see the glory of God. If you would believe. If you would believe, you will see the glory of God. And what happens when we don't believe? Well, we saw in Hebrews 11:6. For without faith it is what? Impossible to please God. Impossible. If you don't have the faith, when God says, well, you know how you feel when you tell someone something, but they don't believe you, and you know that what you're talking about is true, and the glory to go by you, and as his glory passed by, God repeated, he is the compassionate, gracious God. He repeated his attributes, who he was, and basically, the glory of God is who he is. It's what his attributes are like. It's his personality, his characteristics. When you glorify God, you are repeating back to him how great he is, how good he is. And he shows his glory. He's showing his personality to you, his omnipresence. He is everywhere. He's everywhere. His omnipresence, his omnipotence. He's all-powerful. He can do all things. And when you see that he is able to do everything in this world, you are glorifying him. You see his love, that he always does the best for you sacrificially. His sovereignty. He's the king of the mountain. You used to play that game, top of the picnic table. Who's king of the mountain? Pull them off. There's only one king of the mountain. That's God. He is sovereign. He's not only sovereign, he's merciful. In his mercy, he does not give you what you deserve. He's merciful. He's immutable. He never changes. God said to Hosea, I, the Lord God, change not. Therefore, you are not consumed, O Israel. Because God doesn't change. He doesn't change his mind. He's immutable. He's a merciful God, a loving God. He's a good God who does right things for his people. He is a God of forgiveness. He is a God of grace. In his mercy, he doesn't give you what you deserve. In his grace, he does give you what you don't deserve. And all of these things about the eternal Father, his holiness, he always does right. He never does wrong. His omniscience. He knows everything. He also knows the ifs of every situation. Do you remember that Jesus said in the book of Matthew, if the miracles had been done that I'm doing, if they had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented. If they had been done in Sodom and Gomorrah, they would have repented. They were not. But Jesus knows even the ifs of a situation. And the if he puts back to us is if you would believe, you would see the glory of God. Two sisters were about to see his glory. But you know, sometimes the weeping comes first. Joy comes in the morning. Weeping lasts for the night. They're weeping. Now notice the situation here. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and troubled and said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. It's that verse when you have no other that you can quote. He was like, quote to me a verse from Scripture. John 11:35, Jesus wept. Shortest in the English Bible. Jesus wept. What I want you to see here is there's a lot of weeping going on. They were weeping, the people were weeping, but what you don't see here is a difference in these words. When it says they were weeping, it's the word wailing. They were screaming, they were screeching, they're wailing because it seemed so hopeless for them. And they even paid professional wailers to come to funerals, to scream and to fall on the ground. It's all hopeless. There's no reason. Jesus wept. It does mean he shed tears, but it's not the idea of wailing. But still, why? Why did Jesus weep here? He knew what was going to happen. He knew how it was going to turn out. There's something else you need to see with his weeping, and that's some other words that are used here. Notice, they're also weeping. He was deeply moved in spirit and was troubled. Those words are some pretty specific words in the original language. They mean he was snorting. It's used of a stallion that, you know, rises up on its hind legs, snorting, ready to go. It's used of anger. It's used of when you're so angry, you don't go just agitate. Why is he so angry? Why is he so agitated? I think it's because he knows what is behind all of this. And if nothing else, he knows he's going to bring Lazarus back into it. But he knows behind all of this is the devil himself, his enemy. Back in John 8:44, he said, "You are of your father, the devil, and you want to do the desires of your father." He was a murderer from the beginning. We don't know how Satan works into the thing of death, but he does. Because that's what the author of Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. "Therefore, since the children, we, us, share in flesh and blood, he himself, our Savior, also partook of the same, that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death," that is the devil. I don't know how much power Satan has or how it works, because he even had to ask permission to do things to Job. But apparently there is something that Satan, in his authority over this world, has power in death. And Jesus knows he's the end, and the battle is about to begin. And he, Jesus, is going to win the battle. But there's the snorting of the stallion. The battle is about to take place on Calvary. But how dare you take the life of one of my friends? And he's angry, but he knows who looks up. He knows what's going to happen. So Jesus, again, being deeply moved within, came to the stone. Now, it was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Sounds almost like the place that Jesus is going to stay for a few days himself. Stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Remove the stone." Martha, the sister of the deceased, said to him, "Lord, I don't know if you understand this or not. Since you were a little late, did you look to see? It's been 4 days. It's kind of stinky now. Just in case you didn't know that, there will be a stench, or he's been dead for 4 days." And she had basically given into the battle, and she's declaring surrender. But Jesus said, no. "If you would believe, you'd see the glory of God. You would see the attributes of the Father. You would see him work if you would believe." Did I not say to you, and folks, let's go home with this one this morning. Did I not say to you that if you believe, you'll see the glory of God? Standing there, you remember his words? Man, they couldn't make it as dramatic as I'm sure it really was. As Jesus said, "Lazarus, come forth." And he did. He did come forth. And they watched him as the man who had died came forth, bound hand and foot with the wrappings, and his face was wrapped around with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go. This stinky one is alive. He doesn't stink anymore." believe, see the glory of God. God had a purpose in this. He always has a purpose. His purposes are not always the same. His purposes don't always work out the way you and I want them to. But the if is the same for us every time. If you would believe, you would see the glory of God. And as we face the breaking of a new year, the beginning of what is another 365 days that we have to live our normal lives, wouldn't you like to see the glory of God in this new year? Wouldn't you like to see it? Most of us would like it, but we have a tough time with the if. Jesus said, did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? You know what our problem is, don't you? We don't believe. We don't believe. And because we don't believe, so often we don't see what God is willing and wanting to do. We need to prepare ourselves for the new year. And folks, that's the condition you and I need to put in our minds right now. It's the issue of faith. It's the issue of how much we believe God can or will do. I don't know what He will always do, but how do you prepare yourself to believe? Let me suggest a couple of things. They're so simple, you could think of them yourself. But here's one of them. How do you prepare yourself? Number one, know what God said. Know what He said. You don't know what He's going to do or what He can do if you don't know what He said. And what I want to remind you of is no longer is the Bible padlocked to the pulpit. They used to do that because they said, you people,
the peons, the ones who are not the clergy,
you don't understand the Bible. You can't. It's only done by the Holy Reverend Father. You can't. It's not padlocked anymore. In fact, you probably have more Bibles lying around your house than many people have in whole countries. It's not padlocked. Why don't you use it more? I mean, really? Well, I know there are those of you who read it every year. And I know there are some of you who don't read it at all. You say, we count on coming to church. Okay, great. You attend a church that does everything possible to teach you the Word of God. And I don't mind saying that because that's our very purpose. For the church gathered, we're trying to teach you the Word of God, which is a lamp in your feet and a light in your path. We're trying to say to young men, here's where you can make your way clean by taking heed to God's Word. You come, you learn. No tyrant is outlawing reading the Bible yet, although they're getting close and close. Nobody is making you not read it. But I have to say, and this is going to sound pretty tacky, some of you don't take your privilege very seriously at all. We don't. We just don't take it very seriously. God says, this is my love letter to you. I remember the year that I was still in Bible college and Sharon had to take the year off and she was home, and I've still got all these piles of letters that she would send me and things she would cut out. And you know, you'll read, Dear Joseph. Now, why did she say that? Why didn't she say, Dear Precious, or Dear Sugar Booger? But what is it in there? Oh, look what she, oh, she does, she used that word again. Why did she say it this way? It's a love letter. They put her ways out, I'll get to that sometime. No black preacher saying to his people, he said, God wrote you a letter. You young people, God wrote you a letter. And you older people, God wrote you a letter. A question for you. When are some of you going to read your mail? It's getting a little too close to home. Let's go into number two. Respond to what God has said. You see, I want to remind you folks that the Bible is not just for your information, but for your transformation. My question to you is, are you any kinder after this past year that we've looked through Ephesians and Hebrews and we've learned the word? Are you any kinder? Are you any more truthful? Are you any more honest? Are you any more loving? Are you kinder to your spouse? Do your children see more consistency in your life than mine? Is it transforming me? Evaluate your growth each year. As I tell you, every year I ask myself the question, have I grown a whole year's worth this year? Not always. Sometimes yes. Sometimes no. But I have to answer for myself, dear God. Evaluate yourself. Have you grown a whole year's worth this past year that anyone could see? Because it comes down to this. If you would believe, you would see the glory of God. Believe. Let's pray together. Father, I realize that there are folks who may have come in this morning who need to believe your Son for salvation. More than they could ever believe what you would do in their lives, they need to believe that you have given them the gift of eternal life. I pray, Father, that your Spirit would work in the hearts of those who may not know you as Savior and would cause them in faith to come to you and say, I want your salvation. But Father, there are some of our folks who are facing all kinds of difficulty this year. Some with cancer. Some with great heartaches. Father, some have families that are falling apart. And others have feelings that are just tearing them apart. Father, would you help us to be so dependent upon your word that we would know what you've told us and how to respond to these situations. And above all things, understand that even in the very end of things, should you take our lives, the life that we have after this one is far, far better for those who've trusted you. So, Father, help us to evaluate. Help us to move on into a new year. Believe in you and what you can do and will do in our lives. Help us grow, we pray in Jesus' name.
Perhaps you would like to better understand how you can know for sure that you have eternal life. That your, as the song is going to say, your faith has found a resting place. With all the struggles in life and all the difficulties, we can find rest in Christ. And we can have a certain peace to know that when the Lord takes us, we're going to be with Him. But only if you believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we have some folks up front that were willing to help you out. If you're not sure, if you'd like to know better how you can know for sure you have eternal life, they'd be happy to speak with you. And maybe some other things that you need to be talked with about. Some prayers, some of the needs, they're up here to help you. The rest of us, would you stand and sing, My Faith Has Found a Resting Place. And I hope this is certainly true for you this morning.
My faith has found a resting place, not in device or creed. I trust the Thank you.
Father, let us not tarry over the idea of the ifs, but that we would be willing, Father, to say, Lord, whatever your will, and that we would be obedient to those things that you put in our path and in our lives, to understand that you are doing those very best things for us, that your ideas are greater than ours. Father, thank you for hearing us when we even do feel like our prayers are hitting the ceiling. So thank you that you do hear, and it does not fall on deaf ears. But Father, we don't always know how to pray, and we don't always know what's best for us, and we're thankful that you do. We're thankful that as sheep, you do shepherd us. If there's anyone here who has not found that resting place in Christ, who has not made Jesus the shepherd of their life, and are wandering off doing their own thing, and have no hope for eternal life, Father, I pray that today would be the day that they would put their trust in you. As the song says, I need no other plea. It's enough that you die, and that you died for me, and you died for the sins of the world. And if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, that we will be with you one day. So, Father, for those who have not yet reached out and said, Jesus, I believe you saved me, today would be the day. Start a whole new year, refreshed with the Holy Spirit, and a future that is secure. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for coming this morning. God bless.